Proverbs 16, the contrast here in this chapter is between the righteous people and the wicked people. So that's the whole contrast here. Okay, so when we look at this chapter, we look at, you will find again and again this contrast. Okay, the difference, or you could say the contrast between the one who is righteous, what are the characteristics, and the one who is wicked, what are the characteristics. And so a lot of it, as we go further, you will see that it comes from the response or the attitude towards God. Okay, so the first one, the plans of the heart belong to man, but the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. Plans of man, okay? The plans of the heart belong to man, something that we plan in our lives. The first time that when we think about the plans of man is attributed many times, sometimes when you think of salvation, we didn't plan salvation. We didn't think about salvation. We had in our mind, we never thought about it, like the old sin nature when we were unsaved. But what was the answer from the Lord regarding man's fallen nature? Sending his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for our sins. That plan was God's plan. It was never devised in the heart of man. And when we think about the plans of the heart, when they say belonging to man, if you look in chapter 16, same chapter, and Al, we are in Proverbs chapter 16, verse 1. And verse 9 onwards, look, if you look at verse 9, the mind of man plans his way, but the Lord directs his steps. Each one of us, before we got saved, but before we came to know the Lord, we were making our own plans, but God was somehow directing our steps. And this is in the sovereignty of God. We were placed, we were given the opportunity to accept him as our Lord and Savior. And when the opportunity presented itself, we trusted him. When we trusted him, sometimes we waited, sometimes we trusted, sometimes we were doubting and had questions. But when we did that, what was happening was, this was the answer from God. The answer of the tongue is from the Lord, that we began to believe in him, you know. And when we got saved, God removed the heart of stone and gave us a new heart. This new heart now can receive from God. So even if we understand and we make our own plans, in the Holy Spirit speaks to us and guides us. This is the plan of God, you know. God's grace, you know, always goes ahead of us. In life, whenever we want to do anything or we plan for anything, the grace of God always goes before us. And we become the people who are dependent upon God's grace. When we think of this proverb, the plans belong to man, answer from the Lord. Sometimes people take it in a different context and they say, then we should wait till we hear what God says, and then that's wisdom. But this is not a proverb that leads to laziness, that we will not do anything till God replies. It means remain faithful in doing what God has called you to do. You know, remain faithful and do what God has called you to do, but keep depending upon God. Keep depending upon God. You know, and God, this is how God works. First, God works in us. Then God works through us, and then by us. Always the work is first in us. God works in us. Then by grace, he works through us. And then the work is done by us. All the time it is dependent upon God. So we can have a plan. For example, in church, we can have a plan. This is what we need to do. But the Lord is directing the steps in a different direction. Acts chapter 16 is a great example, that the plan of Paul is to go to Asia. But the Holy Spirit's plan and God's plan and the reply from God is go towards Bithynia, go towards Europe. Church history, the church grew, the church expanded because of that one move. When the Lord said, move towards Bithynia, go towards Europe, not towards Asia. That's where, because at that point under the Roman Empire, the roads were available, people were there, there was protection on the way. The gospel could be spread faster. So there can be a plan that is made by man, you know, but the answer comes from God. Christ goes to the cross. You know, the enemy thinks he's won the victory, but the answer is salvation comes from there. You know, the salvation comes from there. We see through scripture, many plans man makes, but we see how God begins to answer. Man's way, man's plan is okay. You know, I am Abraham, I'm called by God. If it's not working through Sarah, let's try it through Hagar. God ordains the steps. God ordains the steps. Our work is to obey. Our work is to depend upon God. His grace goes before us. And when we are walking with God, when we are depending upon God, you know, we are preparing, then God gives us the answer as we are walking in the way. We don't waste our time. We are not idling around. We are just doing by depending. Whatever we do it by depending upon God, you know. In chapter 19 of Proverbs, I think in verse 21, it says, many are the plans in the heart of the man, but the answer is from the Lord. Many are the plans. In here in verse 9 of the same chapter, it says, the mind of man plans his way, but the Lord directs the steps. And that's what we want to think of. In verse 2, all the ways of man are clean in his own sight, but the Lord weighs the motives. In the KJV, it says, all the ways of man seem innocent to him, but the motives are weighed, or the spirit is weighed by the Lord, you know. Because if you ask a person, an unsaved person, are you a sinner? He was never going to say, I'm a sinner. If you ask a person, will you be going to hell? Most people will not say, I'm going to hell. No man condemns himself. No one condemns themselves. No one says, I'm a sinner. No one, because this is how we are. All our ways are clean in our own eyes. When a murderer kills someone, his plan is also this way. He thinks what he did was right. It's right in his mind. It is right in his mind. But the spirit, which is the Lord, weighs the spirit. A great example is Saul. Samuel said, destroy all the animals. Destroy all of Agag. Kill everything. Do not leave anything behind. But Saul decides to keep some animals. Saul decides to spare the king. And when Samuel comes, he says, did you do as the Lord has said? And he says, yeah. Then he says, how come I hear the bleating of the sheep? Oh, I left the best for the people. Disobeying God, he still felt he was right. He was innocent. Why did you kill Agag? No, you know, it is, I think. And what was the answer of Samuel? Obedience is better than sacrifice. Like a man can judge by what others are doing. God will look at the principle why he's doing, the motive behind it, the motive behind it, you know. In Daniel chapter 5, there is the Belshazzar. He brings out the vessels of the temple in chapter 5, verse 27. And he's saying, let's have a party. And they're drinking in the vessels that were in the temple of God. And soon there is a handwriting of the wall. Time is up. It's over. Why? What was the motive? He felt, Belshazzar felt, wow, this is a time to celebrate. Let's celebrate. And the celebrate, we can celebrate with the holy vessels of God. And we can drink liquor in it and all that thing is happening. But he thinks this is innocence. And then comes the writing, many, many. You know, that comes the writing on the wall. Your time is up. It's over. When God looks at us, when God looks at man, he knows there's nothing good in him. There is sin. But man feels, I'm not a sinner. And I'm not a sinner. When temptation comes, we really realize how fallen we can get. When pride comes in, then we realize how much we can fall. And that's the idea, you know, that's the idea that everything we do, we are very good in justifying the sin that we do. When a person practices sin, they will always find a way to justify it. But God is looking at the heart. He's saying, okay, what is this correct? And in the case of Saul, Samuel had to say, listen, it's over. It's over. You may be the king, you may do as you please, but in the eyes of God, it doesn't work that way. God is looking for a man whose heart is after him, and obedience is always be better than sacrifice. And Saul was good in it. Saul said, no, you know, the people made me do it. I was thinking of the people. He was putting the blame on the people. He was trying to show he's concerned about the people. But actually, he wasn't. It was not about the people. You know, he thought what he was doing was right. He wanted the approval of the people. He didn't want the approval of God. That's where he erred in his ways. He said, if I get this man's approval, or these people's approval, I will remain popular in their sight. And God is saying, what about me? Samuel is saying, okay, really? What about God? How can you not get God's approval? You know, it was God who allowed you to come to this position. That's how it is. Man will look at the ways, works. God will look at the heart. We are looking outwardly. God is looking inwardly. That is why David was chosen. Because even man like Samuel thought, the first son of Jesse, the young guys, these handsome, strong men, they are the ones. But when God said, there is one more, when Jesse said, there is one more remaining, it says, Samuel did not even sit down. He said, go get him. Go get him, because he knew that's the king who's coming. Because all these are not qualified. It is an outward thing. Even Samuel fell into that trap in that sense. He looked at it outwardly, and the Lord said, no, not these, this guy, you know. So that's, we remember this in our hearts, that, you know, we can justify the things we do, even if when we are wrong, because that's a part of the sin nature. They will always find a justification for our behavior. But when we understand grace, when we understand forgiveness, when we understand repentance, confession, all those things, we realize that God is looking at the motive of why we did what we did. Not what we did, why we did it. That is also the principle for the Bema seat. It is not going to be so much quantity. It is going to be motive. I served, but why did you serve? Was it to gain approval of men, or was it to bring glory to God? If you did it for the honor of people and people clapped for you, well, that's where you get your reward. It will not come up there, you know. And so this is eternal principle that we live by, that the ways of man, we are always clean in our sight. We never make mistakes. It's always someone else's fault. God is saying, but I'm looking at the motive. Why did you do? Why did you say what you did? You know. So verse number 3, commit your works to the Lord, and your plans which will be established. Some translations say that your plans will succeed. Commit them to God. Psalms 37 talks about this in detail. Commit, trust, and then it says rest. Commit your works, you know, whatever you are going to do, and then rest, because faith is the principle. Without faith, you will find it difficult to commit it to God. And when you obey and commit it to God, then you're supposed to rest. You are supposed to have confidence that this is by God. This is by the will of God. When the mind does not have faith, when the mind operates out of faith, it will always be fluctuating. It will always be, you know, up and down. It will bring in worry. It will bring in confusion. It will bring in uneasiness. Because faith is not there. It will always bring in confusion. But where there is faith, then those plans will succeed, because the Lord will establish them. You know, when we do whatever we do the work, but we depend for strength and guidance upon God. It's never on our own work. You know, it's never on our own work that we do it and we depend upon ourselves. And, you know, 1 Peter chapter 5 verse 7 talks about it. You know, cast your cares upon him. He cares for you. Look to him. If you want success, then look to God. You know, in all that you do, you get his strength, get his guidance. You know, it's safe. And the Lord will help you. in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 3, it talks about the principle of we believe and then we enter into his rest. If we don't have faith, then we'll never be rested. You know, if we have faith, then we'll be rested. We'll be rested. Verse 4. The Lord has made everything for its own purpose, even the wicked for the day of evil. Even the wicked for the day of evil. And when we think of this verse, mind goes back to Genesis. That everything that God does has a purpose. But God does not do anything evil. Absolute holiness. He is infinitely holy, absolutely perfect. So he cannot be the author of sin. He cannot be the author of evil. It cannot happen because God is holy, how can he even look upon sin? How can he even plan evil? It will never happen. When the devil fell, when Lucifer fell and became Satan, he became the author of evil. That was evil in his heart. Iniquity was found in his heart. Pride was found in his heart. And he wanted to be independent of God. So he became independent of God. And that is where, that's how that sin of pride came in. And that is what he wants. Everyone become independent of God. But here the verse says, the Lord has made everything for its own purpose. In Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11, it says, God has made everything in his time, and it is beautiful, and he has set eternity in the hearts of men. He says that there, man in his heart knows that there is eternity. And God in his work, you know, whether it is creation, whether it is nations, whether it is dispensations, whether it is anything, whether it's our life, everything has a purpose. And that purpose is for our good. But majorly the purpose is for his glory. When man chose to sin out of free will, there is punishment. It has to happen. There the justice has to come into play. But then there is God's patience. There's God's love. There is God's providence. And he provides for a way of escape. He provides for a way. God is not the author of sin. You know, he cannot do that. But when he permits it, when he allows it to happen, however he may hate it, it will always be a way that will something good will come out of it in the end. That is bringing him glory. That will bring him glory. The great illustration is the book of or the life of Job. It's a life of Job, you know, that this happened in that story. That God has Job and God is speaking about Job, but then there is a devil and he wants to inflict harm and he wants to, how do you say that, stop the testimony or bring and say the real reason why Job goes after you is something else and you take it away. But in the end, it turns out to be for God. In the end, it turns out to be for God. And this is something that we must remember, that everything that God has made has a purpose. God didn't make anything which says there is no purpose for it. He just made it because there's nothing to be done. Colossians chapter 1 and 16 talks about it, that everything is made by God and for him. So if it is made by him and for him, then there has to be a purpose. You know, he's not saying I'm getting bored, so let me make something which has no purpose. No. Everything has a purpose. And therefore, when we wake up every morning, we must remember this. This new day has come. It has a purpose. When we read the scriptures, we must remember that this has a purpose. When we pray, it has a purpose. When we give out our tract, it has a purpose. When we encourage someone, it has a purpose. God has a purpose behind it. You know, we don't know. God has a purpose behind it. An old friend called today and was encouraging me. You know, just encouraging. He says, I just felt to be praying for you. He's not from a church or even from Greater Grace Church. But he just said, I want to get in touch with you and pray for you. And what is happening is God led him to do something. And it was for a purpose. And it edified me. It encouraged me. I said, wow, you know, somebody is calling me up and wants to pray for me. And those few moments was the purpose of what God spoke to that person. And that's amazing because this is our lives. We must be open to what God is saying to us every day. We should have in our hearts the preparation that when God is speaking to us, there is a purpose. When God is speaking through his word, there is a purpose. It is not just, just for wasting time or, time pass. No, there is a purpose. There is always a purpose. And the greatest purpose is to bring glory to God. The Lord has made everything for a purpose, right? And even the wicked, Joseph's brothers can sell him. But there is a purpose of God, right? Pharaoh can keep holding back the Jews, but God has a purpose. He can destroy the young male babies, but God's purpose is as Moses and Aaron would be saved. They would not be dying. In the New Testament, Herod is wicked, kill all the babies born so that the Messiah cannot come. God had even the wicked what they were doing. They were fulfilling prophecy. Doesn't it say in Exodus, I think it says in Exodus 9, that I'm doing these things at Pharaoh, I'm using him for my glory. even the wicked, when they are doing what they are doing, God is protecting his people and God will get the glory. God has a purpose, Verse 5, everyone who is proud in heart is an abomination to the Lord. Is an abomination to the Lord. Assuredly, he will not go unpunished. Wow. Strong statement. All those who are proud in heart will not go unpunished. By God search the heart. Matthew chapter 6 verse 16, God searches the hearts. People can disguise pride with humility. God knows deep inside what's going on. People can disguise pride by good words. God knows what's going on. In the eyes of God, it's disgraceful. Men may get fooled by it, but in the eyes of God, it's disgraceful. And he will deal with pride. God will always deal with pride. If someone says, what is the greatest sin? Then the greatest sin is pride. And people say, idolatry. Yes, but where does idolatry come from? From pride. Let us make God in my image. I want to make God in how I think he is. Where is that coming from? It's coming from pride. I think I can make God. I think I can make an image. I think I can make a drawing. It is pride. And that will go punished. That will be punished. God will never, tolerate pride. God will never tolerate. Because what is pride? It's a heart that is lifted up against God. It is trying to say, I know better. I can control God. And God will bring it. God will handle it. Everyone who is proud in heart is what? An abomination to God. Abomination. Like God does not even want that around. It's an abomination. You will see that in chapters 11, 20 and 21. We talked about it. And assuredly, guaranteed, they will not go unpunished. Our hearts can very easily submit to pride. Very easily we can slip into pride. Very easily. If someone keeps complimenting you, the heart is very easily moved to pride. Be careful. Be careful of pride. It comes in very subtly. You will not even sometimes realize. And how do I gauge? How do I know whether I have pride in my heart or no? A good way to do is, how is your prayer life going? Is your prayer life all about you? Make me do this, make me that, I am this. Be careful. If your prayer life is all around you, then be careful. Somehow pride has come in. And maybe even you don't know it. Even I don't know it. We don't know it. It can happen to anyone. If that can come in, listen to yourself sometimes. If in the conversation, if we are speaking and I'm speaking only about myself, ? It could be leading to pride. It could be there is some amount of pride that's coming. Go to God and ask the Lord, like we go to God and we say, Lord, if there is areas in my life where I'm proud or help me. I don't want this pride in my life. I want to remain humble before you. I seek your grace. I need you. You know, I need you. I am not independent. I need you. Verse 6, by loving kindness and truth, iniquity is atoned for. And by the fear of the Lord, one keeps away from evil. Now, this word loving kindness is many times used in the scripture, and people are, it thinks about, is many times translated as mercy. So it could read like this. The word is hesed. Some places in the Old Testament, it is used for God's covenant love. Some places it's used for mercy, which is, or grace. So it's either one of these three, or all three. It's love, mercy, and grace. It can be used. It's interchangeably used. So by loving kindness and truth, iniquity is atoned for. What does it mean? You know, when people repent of sin, God forgives and withdraws his judgment. That's his loving kindness. That's the truth. Iniquity is atoned for. When a sinner comes to God and says, forgive me, God does not give the person what they deserve. He holds it back. He gives them grace. He forgives. You know. Then this is linking it. This is linking it. You know, it's a great display of love. Why? Because God did not hold back his own son. He did not hold back Jesus. Pure Jesus. Completely holy Jesus. On the cross. For completely unholy man. God does not hold him back. But when the sinner comes to God, because of what Christ did, loving kindness. The fear of the Lord, one is kept away from evil. By the fear of the Lord, one is kept away from evil. You know, and God's wrath is turned away because he sees his son. He sees his son, you know, and it's turned away. Okay. In verse 7, when a man's ways are pleasing to the Lord, he makes even his enemies to be at peace with him. It's an amazing, amazing proverb. When a man's ways are pleasing to the Lord, this is the grace of God. The grace of God connected to the man or woman of God. You know, we will always have enemies. There is an enemy in the spiritual realm. There is an enemy within us, in the sense, the old sin nature. There is an enemy outside, that's the world system. There are people because of our faith. Now, this enemies that I'm talking about is in relation to our spiritual lives because of who we are in Christ. Sometimes our own family members will not be for us because we are in Christ, and they may turn against us. But the best thing to do is we go to God. We do what is pleasing to God. And when we are pleasing to God, then no one can touch us without God's permission. No one can touch us. The enemies may be many, but they can't touch us unless it's approved by God. Like in any way, I'm not just talking physically, what I'm talking in any other way. When Christ was on the earth, so many times they tried to catch him. So many times they tried to, lay hands on him. But he would never come into their hands. David. So many times they tried to capture him. He would never come into the enemy's hands. But in fact, the enemies would want to reconcile. They don't want him. They don't want him to be attacking him. And the reason is why. It's because his life was pleasing to God. When you notice that when he committed the sin with Bathsheba and the things happened there, he had to go back to war. He had to go back to war. When you read 2 Samuel, and you begin to read the story in that first, when he, then David became king in Jerusalem, you go up to verse 9, chapter 9, you will find out all the things are going well. But after chapter 9, 10, 11, you see war begins to start again. Because he lost, his ways was not pleasing to God. You know, and when his ways were pleasing to God, even the enemies, it's the hand of God upon the people of God. Think about this verse. It is a very practical verse. We are not trying to please our enemies so that they can be good to us. We are trying to follow God. And when we follow God, those who are against us may turn out to become our friends also. Like this can happen. Those who are against us, those who are like wanting to be far away from us, they can become our closest friends sometimes. Or they can just go away. They will not trouble you anymore. Suddenly they are not there. I'm not talking that they are dead. What I'm talking is that they could be far away. When your ways are pleasing to God, then God has a way to protect you. Your enemies, you know, they may be scattered. They may move away. You know, they'll get transferred or they'll go somewhere else or something will happen to them. You know, because your ways are pleasing to God. Because you are walking with God. That is why those things will happen. You know, that is why those things will happen. In verse 8, better is a little with righteousness than great income with injustice. You know, better is a little with righteousness. Than great income with injustice. In chapter 15, verse 16, we talked about this. And it said that in chapter 15, in verse 16, better is a little with the fear of the Lord than great treasure and turmoil with it. Whatever we gain by injustice is going to be of no use. Whatever we gain by selfishness, greed, may look good at the present moment, but it will never bring lasting enjoyment. It will never bring security. Okay? It will never do that. Think of these two people. There is a widow in Zarephath. Okay? There is a widow in Zarephath. She has a little. God has spoken to her that a man of God is coming and you need to feed him. When the man of God comes, she says, I have a little. I was going to prepare it. Me and my son were going to eat it and then we were going to die. She has a little, but she's a righteous woman. She understands this. God has spoken to her. When the man of God comes, Elijah says, hey, listen, prepare it for me and then do whatever. You can think that this is being insensitive, but if you read that chapter carefully, you realize that God, when God spoke to Elijah, he said, go to the woman in Zarephath. I have commanded her to sustain you. So she was there. God had already spoken to her. Right? Now, she has little. But she's right with God. And at the same time, at that same moment, there is a queen in the land. You know, her name is Jezebel. She has by injustice picked up vineyards and palaces. And she is royal. She's a queen and everyone is scared of her. But who is the one who's more satisfied? Who is the one who really will enjoy the provision of God? And this widow in Zarephath, till the time the famine did not end, she would not experience a lack. The flour would always be there. The oil would always be there. She had a little, but with God, it would sustain her till the end of the famine. And there is this queen, Jezebel, who has a lot, but she's always wanting more. She's always desiring more. She's always wanting, I want. The leech has two daughters, give and give. The leech sucks blood, right? But they are never sad. They'll bloat and bloat and bloat and they'll be ready to explode, but they will not stop sucking the blood. That is the style, that is Jezebel's lifestyle. I want, I want, I want. I just gather, 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 take in, no matter how it comes. by lies, by this, whatever, take it. What's the end? She was thrown down. It ended, you know. It ended. Who is revered? Who do we think of and say, wow? We think of the widow and we say, she had a little, but see what God did. And at the same time, there is a queen, Jezebel. She had a lot and see what happened. Where there is injustice, where there is this gathering by, you know, harming someone, fooling someone, stealing from someone, manipulating, it's not going to be, the end is not good. God gets involved in it, you know. And I'm not saying that God will not bless us or give us and all those things. Whatever he gives with godliness is better than a lot without godliness. You know, that's the key. Like it is not how much I get. It is whatever I have with godliness will always be a profit. We need godliness more, you know. Verse 9. The mind of man plans his way, but the Lord directs the steps. Again, we talked about it, verse 1. Why is this word written, the mind of man plans his way? Why? Because man has a free will. That's why the mind of man prepares so much. Without free will, we are like machines. We are robots. God gives us free wills. But how does God direct the steps? Mystery. It's a mystery. Sometimes God allows some things. Sometimes he overrules it. Sometimes he stops us. Man will propose. God will dispose. Man plans. Then the Lord will show the direction. So it's good to plan. It's good to plan with God. Sometimes we plan and we say, Lord, this is my plan. Should I go forward or no? Sometimes God will say, go forward. And then a little later, he'll change the direction a little bit. And then we don't say, now suddenly direction is changing. And the direction is changed by God is because he's directing you. And in that direction, it'll become the fulfillment of what God wants it to happen. You know, we use the word providence, providio. In Latin, the word is providio. Providio means to see beforehand. God's providence. God sees beforehand what's going to happen. And that's why he allows sometimes, you know. A person can do something very simple, but in the end, the result can be great. Sometimes we are making our plans and then nothing is happening. Door doesn't open up. Plans doesn't come, doesn't fulfill. We try to do it and nothing happens. Our plan. Sometimes there's difficulties and we need to ask that if doors are closing and it's not happening, what is God trying to say? Is God leading me in this? Is the Holy Spirit's conviction leading me into this? If it is not, then stop, wait and look for and ask this question. Lord, is this my plan or your plan? What is the way? Direct my steps. The Holy Spirit knows. Providio, providence. He knows beforehand. He knows the end from the beginning. Chapter, same, verse 10. No, actually verse 10 to 13. A divine decision is in the lips of the king. His mouth should not err in judgment. A just balance and scales belong to the Lord and all the weights are his concern. It is an abomination for kings to commit a wicked act, for the throne is established on righteousness. Righteous lips are the delight of kings, and he who speaks right is loved. Now, all these verses, four verses, are talking about kings. So basically, this is a manual for someone
We can't hear you, Pastor.
Pastor Atul, I think something has gone wrong with your internet. We can't hear you.
You're on mute, Pastor.
Yeah, I think for a moment it got disconnected. Okay, so the idea behind the proverb is that the king has been appointed, but he is not to look out for his own interest. He is supposed to look out for the interest of his people. He is not saying, how can I be blessed, but how can I be a blessing to someone else? That's the whole idea. That's why the king has been given that position. God gives it. Be careful, he's saying. You know, surround yourself with, like he says here, you know, the just balance and scales belong to the Lord. Make sure that there is justice. Abomination for king to commit wicked acts. Throne is established in righteous lips and a delight of the kings. And he who speaks right is loved. You know, there is a story in church history that there was this king called Constantine, and he had a father whose name was Constantius. Okay, Constantius. He wanted to surround himself with faithful counselors. So he tested the character of the Christians. And what did he say was this? That you are going to sacrifice to one of the gods that I worship. So he pushed the Christians to worship idols, his own gods. Some of them compromised and said, okay. But some, they would not budge. They would say, no, we are not going to do this. Those who compromise, Constantius told them, like, throw them out of the kingdom. I don't want them here. But those who did not budge and stayed faithful to God, he says, these are the people I want. I can trust these people. I can value them. This is the word he used. These men I can trust. I value them more than all my treasure. Why is he saying that? He says, those who have proved themselves that they are faithful to God, they will show they are faithful to their king also. They will stand for what is right. And so he wanted to surround himself with faithful counselors so that he could do what is best. And this is, in a way, you know, this is the idea that when a person, wherever we may be, it could be in the home, you know, the husband is, let's say we are saying this, the husband is the head of the home, then what he's supposed to be doing? Just balance, decision from the Lord, you know. And when it comes to kings, when it comes to positions, when it comes to authority, when it comes to leading, then these are important. Do not err in judgment. Do not err. Don't make mistakes. Don't make bad judgment calls. It is a responsibility of the king. Why? Because bad judgment calls will bring suffering upon the people. Rehoboam said, I am going to increase the burden of taxation upon you. Problem. He was not surrounded by faithful counselors. You know, the weights, just balance and scales belong to the Lord. Do justice. Righteous lips are the delight of kings, and he who speaks truth is loved. Okay, verse 14. The fury of a king is like messengers of death, but a wise man will appease it. This is a picture of what it used to be like a king in the East in those times. His will would become the law. If he would issue an order, then it has to happen. No delay, no resistance, no one can. If you try and resist it, then it's over for you. But wisdom, it says here, you know, but a wise man will appease it. I was thinking of the story of Esther, that the decree goes out because of Haman, that everyone is to kill the Jews. But in wisdom, Esther approaches, and we remember that story for such a time as this. In wisdom, Esther approaches, and then she says, I know this cannot be written, but overrule it. Overrule it, you know. And that's exactly what happens. Like when the wisdom comes, the fury of the king, but a wise man will appease it. A wise man will appease it. So it's a graphic picture, actually. Life and death is the hand of the king. And his will, he'll do whatever he wants. But the wise person cannot, you know, if there is no wisdom, then you cannot calm his wrath down. You cannot calm his wrath down. Okay, so we'll stop here and then we'll begin. We'll take it up next week and finish the chapter. Okay, so we're opening it up. Anyone has a question, comment, please go ahead.
Pastor, on the first verse, I'm sorry, I know you explained it in a lot of detail, but when I read it, I feel like turning it the other way around and, you know, you're like wanting to say the preparation of the heart belongs to the Lord, but the answer of the heart, because that's typically what happens to us, right? I mean, I feel, for me personally, you know, yes, we long for something, but still what comes out of our mouth always is not the right thing that comes out of the mouth. So, I mean, I was just wondering on the second part, I know you explained it in verse 9 as well, because the Lord has given us a free will. But, you know, if that's the way it is, then why is it that sometimes we are so hurtful with what we say, or we end up saying the wrong things? And
yeah, you know, when it comes to the ability to make the plans, then God gives it to us, you know. But the question always remains is, who has the last say? We have the ability. God gives us the ability. But the ability is given so that we would say or do things depending upon God. That's why we have the Holy Spirit in us. That we would want to do it depending upon God. The question here is that the plan in the heart belongs to man. God has said, okay, I give you that freedom to do it. You have the choice to do it. No question about it. No problem about it. But how are you wanting to do it? Do you want to do it without God or with God? Because in the end, the final say is going to be God's. We may think it is us, but it's going to be God. And if the end of it is going to be with God, then our duty, basically, I wouldn't say duty, but I think our work is to depend upon Him. If the final answer is going to come from God, then we better depend upon Him. Sometimes I think of salvation in this way, that a person can choose to say, I live my life on my own terms. But when everything is over and he stands before God, then the final answer is from God. You cannot be in heaven. You did not choose to live on my terms. You know, you were given the opportunity to repent and turn away. You chose not to. But to those who have believed, what have they said? We trust you. To them, the final answer is, you can come into heaven now. You know, that applies not only to salvation, but other things in life also. Not saying that, you know, everything we do it, we are worried about whether I go to heaven or no. What I'm trying to say is that there is the plan and the will of God. And there are times I can make my own plans without consulting God. And I can say some things without having the heart of God. And if I'm not sensitive to what the Holy Spirit is saying to me or how my walk with God is, then sometimes we can make those mistakes. We can say things that are unedifying. We can, you know, do things. But in the end, you know, because grace, as I said, grace goes ahead of us. God will turn us around. He will, in His grace, He will reveal to us that this could have been done in this way or said in this way. And that grace, you know, without making us feel guilty, encourages us to draw closer to God. It encourages us to draw closer to God. So it can happen to any one of us. But this is how we think with this is, we go back to the grace of God and we say, okay, I am not going to do things for which I have not received the grace of God. You know, if I'm not peaceful about it, then I'm not going to do it. I can plan, but I'm going to do this by trusting God, not depending upon my own strength. And that is where things will change. You know, that is how grace works, that it gives you sufficient strength to do what God has planned for you. Sometimes because we can get, we don't see the big picture sometimes. And because we don't see the big picture, we can get upset, we can get angry, we can say things, but we may not mean it. And just because, you know, we don't see the end of it. And God is saying, okay, I'll have the last word. I'll have the last word. And when he does, when he says, we receive it. We say, thank you. Thank you. This is course correction for me a little bit, but graciously done. Graciously done by God. I don't know if I'm making complete sense, but this is what I think. This is how God, you know, has the last say in every matter. And that's why this, the verse, you know, verse 4, he has made everything for its own purpose. It's very important to understand that. So that's what I think. Anyone else can add what they feel led to. You know, I don't know if it makes fully complete sense to you, Albert.
No, it does. It does. I'm just thinking over what you just said, and I'm sure it does make sense. Yeah. I still wish I could turn it the other way around.
Yeah. I think there's a, is it 19:21? Yeah, I think Proverbs 19:21 also gives a good answer. It says, many are the plans in the man's heart, but the counsel of the Lord will stand. You know, the counsel of the Lord will stand. It basically is saying that what the advice given by God is, that is what is going to be fulfilled. And I think Isaiah chapter 14. Let me see what that verse says. Oh, this is a good one. In Isaiah chapter 14, there's a verse which is a judgment on Assyria. And Isaiah 14, it talks about in verse 12 onwards, the fall of Lucifer. How have you fallen from heaven, O star of the morning, son of the dawn? You have been cut down to the earth. You who weakened nations, but you said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. This is the five I wills of the devil. I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit on the mountain of the assembly in the recesses of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the cloud. I will make myself like the Most High. This is the five I wills of the devil. Nevertheless, you will be thrust down to Sheol, to the recesses of the pit. In verse 26 and 27, it's basically pronouncing a judgment on Assyria, but this is what the verse says. This is the plan devised against the whole earth, and this is the hand that is stretched out against all the nations. For the Lord of hosts has planned it, and who can frustrate it? And as for his stretched out hand, who can turn it back? So there is a plan that the enemy did, but look at what God did, you know. And Isaiah is saying that who can frustrate that plan? Because in his wisdom, God has done exactly perfect, you know. And so the enemy or the devil has a way and a strategy, but the end, God has a plan. And that plan cannot be frustrated. The devil's plans will be frustrated, you know. He thinks that by sending the Antichrist and trying to destroy the Jews, and he thought the same thing when Jesus was born, destroy the young male babies. Didn't work. God's plan. He ended up, all that ended up fulfilling prophecy. There is a voice in Rama crying out because the children were being killed. Now, Remember, it was not a lot because it was in a particular district. And so most historians believe that there must be, you know, between 100, close to 100. It was not like a mass genocide. But even if one baby is killed, but that was Herod's idea. And the idea was that the Messiah would not come in, but you could not frustrate God's plan, you know. And so it is good to depend upon his grace and upon his word.